small business owner is difficult even when there's not a pandemic going on, one that is directly affecting bottom line and lives everywhere. I want to walk you guys through the steps that you need to take, ensuring that you legally protect your business, but also set yourself up for success should something else like this happen to you. My name is Rachel Brinke. I am a business strategist and intellectual property attorney for entrepreneurs. Most importantly, I'm an entrepreneur just like all of you. I understand that the legal stuff is no fun, but it's a necessity that we need to focus on in our businesses. Now, we'll get on to all of that here in a bit. I just want to share a little bit about me before we dive in. I have a top podcast called Business Advice Podcast, Quick Education for Busy Entrepreneurs, 12 to 15 minutes on topics of legal, marketing, and business, because I know all of you are so extremely busy. I also own multiple businesses and a law firm as well. You guys can check it all out at rachelbrinke.com, but when I'm not doing all that fun stuff like podcasting, authoring books, working with clients just like you, I'm hanging out with my family. I am a mom of five. My husband is a disabled Army veteran, and we have three puppy dogs that I absolutely love, and I'm a huge fan of tacos as well. I know that COVID has impacted many of you. It's also hit our family as well. I want to share these legal steps, though, not just specific to COVID. We will go over COVID specifics, but I want to talk about some normal things that we need to do in our business anyways, to avoid liability, to set ourselves up for success. Before we dig into all the legal specifics, I have to give my big disclaimer. Well, I am an attorney. I'm not your attorney, unless you want me to be, and we can talk about that later. All the information in these videos are going to be specific to United States, and they're only for general information. Because you're the CEO, you're the head, you are the thought leader in your company. You should know all the facets of it, including legal. This doesn't necessarily mean that I'm saying take this information and run with it and do it yourself, but you should be able to formulate a checklist by the end of this so that you can take it to local counsel to make sure you're doing the right steps. So just understand this is general information. It's pretty good for across the United States, but there might be specifics in your individual state that you want to have checked out. One of my favorite things to say to clients is you never have an issue until you have an issue, whether it's during a pandemic or just in normal times, whatever that means, right? But you never have an issue until you have an issue. And I'll tell you what, I travel to speak nationally, internationally on legal stuff for entrepreneurs all the time. Well, when we could travel, right? And inevitably, every time that I go to a conference, I'm speaking about contracts and liability and some of the things we're gonna learn in this. And oh man, I can't even tell you the multitude of times that people will come up to me after and say, hey Rachel, that was a wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. Good to hear the info. But you know what? I've never had that problem. Someone's never stolen any of my brand visuals. Or no, I just don't use contracts in my business because I haven't had a problem yet. Within a year, I almost always, from every conference that I've ever spoken at, for people that have come up and said that to me, they're in my inbox at the law firm asking for help. Happy to help y'all, but here's the thing. It is cheaper and easier to prevent issues than having to play cleanup on aisle four later. And you know, one of the little silver linings, if you want to call it that, coming out of COVID, is that so many business owners recognized they were not prepared. They were not prepared for liability protection. They were not prepared in their contracts or services or sales to their consumers. They were not prepared in case they ended up getting sick or having to shut down. We're gonna walk through all the steps here that you need to identify what needs to be done in your business. I just am starting here to say, legal stuff is so important, being proactive, because it's not if you have an issue, it's going to be when. And I'm saying this to you as an entrepreneur just like you. Yeah, I'm a lawyer, but I also run non-legal businesses, and I would rather be focused on those businesses and my family and doing hobbies and things I enjoy, rather than having to spend a lot of time, money, and energy with a lawyer to clean it all up later. I promise you, it is cheaper to do it on the front end. So I invite you, dig into all of these. Even if you think you have each of these sections on lockdown, listen to it anyways. I'll be throwing little nuggets out, and either it will tell you, oh great, here's a change I can make, or it could reinforce and give you more confidence that, hey, I've done it right already. You can check that item off. So let's go ahead and dig in. Anytime that I work with entrepreneurs, I always start with what I call the legal triad. So whether you're brand new, you're gonna need to be going through this, or you've been in it a while, use it as a recheck. It is three main tools that are going to protect you from liability in your business. No matter if you're service-based or product-based, virtual or brick and mortar, you want to have these things in place. They're gonna be your business entity that is set up separate from yourself, having business liability insurance, and utilizing the right legal contractual documents in your business. For the very first one, for business entity, I see this happen so often with entrepreneurs. Many of us are in industries where it is not regulated. You're not required to set up an entity like a lawyer or a CPA might be. You can simply set up a Facebook page, set up a website, and you're in business. When you do that, you're considered what's called a sole proprietorship. There is no division between you and your personal assets or you and your business. It's all together. There is no division between you and your business. It's all in one. Think of it like a bucket. You have one bucket. You put in your business assets and your personal assets. That is all together, commingled. What does that mean for y'all? When there's a problem, that customer can come along, they can pick up that bucket, and they can touch both your personal and your business assets. What we're wanting to look for is being a business entity, creating at the state level either a limited liability company or a corporation. There are other structures available too. These are the main ones that I see that many solopreneurs or smaller entrepreneurs focus in on. Many of you, if it's only you, you're probably gonna fall into the LLC or limited liability company category. So what do these do for you? Well, instead of one bucket, we have two buckets now. One bucket holds your personal assets, another bucket holds your business assets. Separate bucket liability protection. This isn't a be-all and end-all. You have to make sure you maintain the filings, you do all the corporate formalities that are required by the state, and make sure you're not doing things to do what's called piercing the corporate veil. But for the most part, if an issue happens, all right, not if, when an issue happens, that customer can come along, and what can they touch? Well, the goal is for them to only be able to touch the business assets. Well, if at all, we're gonna be going through the other legal triad tools here because we're gonna try to keep them from getting to touch anything. Because again, it's not if a problem happens, it's when. So make sure that you have the proper business entity formation done. Make sure that you maintain it. And also make sure that you are reevaluating as your business grows to see if that's what's best for you. I will identify here a word of caution. When you're going to do these filings, I highly recommend that you do not do them yourself unless you've got into a course or you have the other documents needed. Because here's one of the big downfalls. The government does provide the initial documents to get set up with them, but they don't provide additional documents such as operating agreements and bylaws, etc., that are required by many states in order to have that full two bucket liability protection structure set up. Okay? So what happens, many entrepreneurs we'll go, oh, I'm gonna go sign up for my LLC. I did it, I'm good to go. That's not the be all and end all of it. You really need to ensure that you're checking off all the corporate formality boxes, because when a problem happens, a savvy attorney on the other side could realize, hey, they don't have their operating agreement. They're not tying their contracts to that LLC. They're not doing X, Y, and Z. And that's a workaround to keep you guys from having liability protection. They work around it, go right to you, and can touch both personal and business asset buckets. My second big tip for this is please don't have a CPA make the decision for you on which to be. CPAs and accountants are absolutely wonderful. I have my own. I recommend them. They come into my courses and teach as well because I know enough on taxes to be dangerous. But I highly suggest that you have an attorney and a CPA work in tandem because CPAs are fantastic on the tax side of things, but they're not licensed to think about the liability aspect. So we want to make sure that we have both working together. So that's just a little word to the wise to stick with having both on your team and in your corner to making sure that you're doing the right thing for your business formation up front. The second legal triad protection tool is maybe not so much legal, but it can come into play when legal issues arise. Business liability insurance. This is ensuring that you're going to be able to have an insurance policy to assist you when a problem happens so that they can help to resolve it for you. In fact, let me pause right here real quick. With this triad, typically looks like this, I want you to consider them more like hurdles between you and your customer who may have a problem, right? You may have done everything in the world right, but they just are unhappy or just life circumstances have outlined and they are unhappy and want to come at you. These triad tools are going to try to be the hurdles before they can get to you. We start with business entity, then we're moving to business insurance, and then, you know, the last one on the outer is going to be contracts, which we'll get into all of that here in a second. And just keep in mind, having business liability insurance is extremely important. Don't rely on homeowners or renters insurance because they often exclude business for liability and for equipment, but you want to make sure that you have a good policy in place. And the third main tool that we want to have here are the proper legal contracts in place. Now, these may vary a little bit depending upon the industry or the business that you're doing. But for the most part, almost all of us are offering either products or services. So you want to have like a services agreement or a product sales agreement. Could be terms on a website, terms on your Etsy shop. Anything like that needs to have outlined to create the legal relationship with you and the customer. It also helps to set expectations between you and the customer. It provides you some structure and benefits that not having a contract does not. There's a common belief that, okay, a customer sues me, takes me to court, because it does happen all the time, that if I win, because you didn't do anything wrong, well, I'll get my attorney's fees paid. That's not the way it works. There's only two general ways that you're gonna get your attorney's fees. One, it's in a contract, such as a services agreement or product sales agreement, or two, they violated something in the statute. That's probably not going to happen. More than likely, it's going to be a breach of contract issue, whether you have a physical contract or not. And one of the only ways to get those attorney's fees paid for, because you didn't do anything wrong and you won, is to have it in an agreement. That's just one example to put in place. So make sure that we have these contractual documents. Now, more specifically, and we're going to get into here in a little bit for COVID, are going to be waivers. Waivers of or release of liability. It's going to be something that your client can consumer, your customer, whatever it is you call them, if they are coming into your business or you are working individually together, they're going to be signing. Typically, they are for very extreme, dangerous type of activities, skydiving and so forth. But as you're going to see here in a little bit with COVID, it has really become super popular for almost all businesses, and I'm recommending it to my clients as well, to have one of these in place that the client is understanding. If they come into your place of business, they are assuming the risk of potentially getting COVID. No matter how much you work hard of it, they are assuming the risk of that, and they're going to waive any liability pursuit that they could have against you. We have two more types of legal documents to go through. One, really quickly, is your website terms and privacy policy. They are going to govern the relationship between you and a website visitor. And the privacy policy, which is required by many states now, and hopefully it'll be all soon, is to be put into place to put the consumer on notice of how you're getting info, whether it's by tracking them with Google Analytics, they're filling out a form, and what you're gonna do with that information, how you store it, and what information is stored. We want to have that. And the last major bucket of our legal documents is either have an intellectual property transfer document or a proper commercial licensing document. think. You go to get your headshots or marketing photos done. If the photographer retains the copyright, they're going to need a license to you the commercial use of those photos. If you want to own the copyright of those photographs, then that's where the intellectual property transfer document would come into play. Now, keep in mind, I threw in a couple extra contracts on here for you. When it comes to the legal triad itself, business entity of LLC or corporation, typically, business liability insurance, the major one for the third part of the triad is the services or purchase agreement. So make sure that you have those three on lock, because so many business owners during COVID realized they didn't have any of that. They were scrambling to get it done. And luckily, many of them hadn't had issues yet. So if you're someone that needs to get it done, make that a priority to get taken care of, because we don't know how long COVID's going to be. And even if COVID disappeared tomorrow, it's a very important legal thing that you need to have in place. Have at least a release of liability document or assumption of risk document that your customers or clients are going to sign. If you're an online-based business, obviously this is not going to apply. This is more if you have a brick and mortar, you're going to people's homes, or you're meeting them somewhere to provide them services. So we want to have this waiver in place. Now, my recommendation, even show up on that day, because we want them to have time to read it, understand it, and get it back to you. You don't want to waste your time, you know, reserving for them to come into your office or you going to meet them somewhere and they decide they're not going to sign it. Again, this document is going to outline things such as they assume the risk of coming out to your business place or meeting you somewhere that COVID exists and they could potentially get it, and also that they are going to release you of any liability if you have it. I will caution you here. This is not a golden ticket for if you have been come in contact with somebody, if you have had it yourself or you're having symptoms, you can't knowingly show up and have them sign it, them get sick and you say, oh, well, you signed the document, because other circumstances have come into play. And it's just, first of all, that's just wrong. But second of all, no judge is gonna hold that up. So keep in mind, we want to have this assumption of risk document in place and that we're using it smartly and getting it signed ahead of time. I also recommend you have your own internal policies of what you're going to do with COVID. If you come down with COVID, or if your client reaches out and says they have symptoms, think about what are the things that you want to do. Obviously, if they pop up sick, you want to believe them and you want to reschedule, because you don't want to put yourself at risk. But you also have to identify at what point are you going to allow reschedules? Are you going to charge for reschedules? These are the business policy things that you need to think about. I also think it's extremely important, if you're a brick and mortar business, for you to have a posted policy of what you're doing. And y'all have seen this if you've gone anywhere. People are posting on their front doors, you know, if you have had these symptoms or this long list of 20 things like we're going to talk about in the questionnaire shortly, please don't come in. But you also want to pair that with letting your customers know, what is it that you are doing with COVID? What is it that you're providing? You know, when pandemic first hit and then we were starting to open up, we had these onslaught of emails, especially from restaurants, telling us how they were protecting their employees and protecting their customers. This was for a couple of reasons. One, it helps to educate the consumer that's going to be coming into their facility. It inspires confidence in them, but it also is something that is proof. Should there be a problem where somebody comes to your building or your office, whatever type of business you have, and they say that they got it from you because you don't do X or whatever, this would be something that you could point to should there ever be a problem and say, hey, these are our policies. We adhere to them. Policies such as things that the CDC is recommending. And you could even take that a step further if you want, but also make sure that you are staying in line with any government mandates as well. And lastly, we want to have a questionnaire that the client or customer that's coming into your business, or you're going to them, or you're meeting them somewhere, that they attest to. And many of you have done this already, but they're basically saying they know, you know, they haven't had symptoms in X amount of days, they haven't been out of the country, they've not been exposed, you know, by someone that has been positive, all those sorts of things. There's a whole long list of them, but we want to have that for the day of. It does no good for you to get it a month before you're going to meet with them. So Assumption of risk waiver is done like when you book with the client and before you even go to see them. And then the day of is when I would suggest sending and telling them this questionnaire needs to be signed or filled out before we're even going to engage in business today. Now, I do want to throw in here some legal document tips. These are not just COVID specific. These are for even like the purchase and services agreements we talked about earlier. They should be lawyer drafted. What I mean by this is either go and have a lawyer completely draft it from scratch or come to someone that has contract template forms for your industry and take and have them do a little revision. The good thing about investing in contract template forms, especially when they're industry specific, is that they are gonna be a lot more well-rounded than a typical business contracts attorney is going to draft. Because think about it, the majority of attorneys have not ever run a business. And if they have, it's probably been a legal business. So they don't necessarily know the pain points of what you're going through. They don't know or can contemplate how your clients or customers are going to react to certain things in there. They don't understand that. But there are some wonderful lawyers out there that are also entrepreneurs. That's fantastic. People like us are unicorns, so love them and keep them. But definitely recommend getting contract template forms from someone and a trusted source to take with you to have just a quick revision. And actually, it can be cheaper in the long run because the amount of billable hours an attorney would charge or even their flat rates is going to be well beyond the amount of time that quick revisions on a really good solid contract template form would provide for you. I also recommend that we look at contracts and legal documents as expectation setting tools, legal protection tools, and customer service tools. So we can have things like in our services agreement where someone's on a payment plan and we say, put in there, if they miss a payment, there's a late fee. Well, guess what? You're contractually able to charge it, but you can provide customer service and not enforce it at all if you don't want to. But in the inverse, let's say that someone keeps dragging their feet and making excuses and just not paying. If you didn't have a contract or your contract did not assess and identify late fees, you can't arbitrarily charge them after the fact. So we always want to have the contract to be the bar, but then we can use it for customer service. And I really, really recommend do not use contracts to beat your clients over the head with. Allow them to be the expectation setting tools, to be there to outline the expectations and obligations between both of you. It's gonna build up their confidence and it's also gonna build up yours. And lastly, I love looking at contracts as letting them be the no man. Think of the movie Liar Liar with Jim Carrey. Probably dating myself a little bit with this. But in that movie, when he gets pulled over and the cop's like, do you know why I pulled you over? He tries to say no, yes. He tries to say no and he says yes. Entrepreneurs do this all the time because we're afraid of rejection, we're afraid of losing a client or customer, we just don't know how, we don't like these uncomfortable conversations. Let the contract be the bad man for you. Let the contract be the no man for you. You can always point and say, well, per the contract, X, Y, and Z. Hey, Emily, per the contract, your payment was due February 1st, but I've not received it in 20 days. I'm gonna need to do the late fee of $15 that was in there. Or some example like that. Allow the contract to be the bad guy, so to speak, right? Helps provide a little bit of a spine, lets it be a no man for us, and at the end of the day, it also legally protects us. Let's talk about the best practices for the contract documents that you're gonna use in your business. Well, obviously, we wanna make sure they're backed up, because once you get them drafted, or you've downloaded them, or you've made your revisions, you don't wanna lose it later. But I do recommend for when you have a finalized version and you're putting it out into the world, go ahead on your calendar and maybe mark a reminder for a year from now, maybe not that long, kind of depends on where you are in your growth of your business, but you want to make sure you're having routine evaluations and revisions to your contract for multiple reasons. One, your business is growing, your business policies are going to change, your pricing is going to change, your liability is going to go up because you're growing to success, right? We want to make sure that all the specifics in your contract are going to meet that. And secondly, your business policies and the things that you offer are also going to change. Do not be someone that never adjusted their pricing in their contract, even if they did on their website, because guess what document is going to be looked to if there's ever a problem? It's gonna be the pricing that you had on the contract from 5 years ago, and the client's gonna wanna pay that and not the price that's going to be on the website. We also want to identify to see, has your business structure changed? Are there any sorts of things in that area? Your contact information. This sounds so simple, but in the grand scheme of being an entrepreneur, legal stuff is just no fun. And honestly, when you have a 500 balls juggling in the air, it's the one that ends up falling. So let's go ahead and put onto the calendar to have this review. In fact, the first of the year is a really good time to do this. Everyone's motivated, pumped, they're identifying the new changes for their business. Put the contract revisions and checking it out in there. Second of all, we want to make sure that we're actually utilizing them every time in our business. Depending on what document it is, we want to make sure that we're actually legally protected. This definitely includes friends or family. I don't want you to feel gun shy about utilizing contracts with friends, family, or even strangers, because this is a business, this is not a charity. Doesn't mean you necessarily have to charge them the same amount of money as your stranger clients, but you want to make sure that you have the legal protection in place, because you never have an issue until you have an issue. Plus, contracts are expectation setting tools. They're outlining to you and the person signing it with you exactly what's expected of each and what each is going to receive. There's really no reason why not to. In fact, the way I look at it, as an attorney and an entrepreneur, but primarily an entrepreneur, contracts are professional. They are providing all these benefits to you, but they're also providing benefits to the client, customer, or consumer that you're getting into business with. So put it in place, have the protection in case you need it. I certainly hope you don't, but you can't go back. Once an issue has happened, it's very difficult to try to unwind it. We would rather spend the time, money, and energy up front utilizing these rather than trying to fix it later on. I also strongly suggest using it as digital as you can. If you're a service-based business, utilize electronic signature, whether it's in person on a tablet or by emailing it or through an online contract signing system. There are so many available out there. Highly recommend you getting that done, because when you're doing the signature online, which is protected and able and lawful to do, it's automatically storing it for you. So you're not having to go and scan the paper and store it for you. It's automatically stored. And actually, another step, if you're sending a .doc to clients, please don't do that, because they can change it, send it back to you, and you may not even recognize what was changed. And also, if you're sending a PDF or a doc to them and having them download it and sign it, that's fine. That's your prerogative. But I'll tell you what, I don't know how many times, because I'm so extremely busy, people send me .docs and then I have to go find paper, go find ink, get on Amazon, order ink because the printer is out of ink, wait for it to come in, then I have to remember to find the time to print it, sign it, scan it, and send it back. There is absolutely no need. We can lower our footprint on the earth by reducing the amount of paper, and we can make it efficient for the consumer and also for us. So digital contracts are the name of the game. And lastly, one would think this would go without saying, but make sure you're always identifying who it is that you're getting into the contract with. You need their name, and I would recommend their address, then obviously the signature and the date. It's really important that we include this, especially when it's a services or purchase type based agreement. We wanna have the identifying information so that we can connect together through that contract and you both can be legally protected. Before we dig into this, I want to share with you a little bit of a personal story. See, I've been in entrepreneurship since I was 19, 20 years old. I have had multiple types of businesses. I've sold them off, some failures, some wonderful successes. But at age 20, I had no idea what was waiting for me. I ended up getting diagnosed with cancer. And I was doing some consulting. I had an online apparel store. I had all these things going on, young child as well. Husband was away with the army. And I didn't have a contingency plan in place. I didn't have any sort of way to have anybody be able to work in my business, notify my clients, or anything like that of what was going on. And in fact, had it been really bad, even though I had multiple surgeries and radiation, I'm obviously well now, if it had gone south very quickly, it would have been very difficult for anyone in my life to be able to pick up the business and carry on to keep that money coming in, or to wrap it up at all without court involvement. This is why it's extremely important that we identify a disaster plan. If you are in your business and you are the only one that's able to do anything, you need to have a couple things in place. If you're in business, you have a team, etc., here's some tips for you to put a couple more tools in place to ensure whether something happens to you short term or, God forbid, long term. When creating our disaster plan, we want to think about the big D's, right? Disaster, divorce, death, disability. We want to have these plans in place just in case one of these happens to us. We don't want to leave our friends or family having to clean up, fight with the courts, and figure out what to do. And even in some cases, that wouldn't even make sense. Maybe it's short term. I've seen some business owners during COVID who ended up with COVID, ended up in the hospital, and they're trying to get some of these tools put into place from inside the hospital. We don't want to do that to ourselves. We don't want to do that to others. So let's walk through the recommended process for creating this disaster plan. First, I want you to write down those 4 D's and think about, what do I want to do if one of these happens? Disaster is super common. We have natural disasters all the time. It could be something big like that, or it could simply be a disaster that directly impacts your business. What is the contingency plan when a disaster happens? Death. Who is it that you are identifying to wrap up your business affairs? Or do you have a business succession plan in place? We're not gonna get too deep on that here. I wanna discuss a little bit more about COVID, but death obviously is gonna happen at some point. You might still be in business. You never know what's gonna happen. The third of the D is divorce. We wanna make sure that we are protected and set up. What happens in case of divorce? I know that sounds a little funny to throw in here. Divorce can have extreme consequences on business. You wanna make sure that's in place. And then lastly, disease. What happens here when you are sick, like with COVID or with cancer? It could be something short-term, it could be something long-term. And that's really where I want to hone in here. We want to ensure that you have identified a key person that's going to be able to carry on the business activities or wrap them up for you. But you can't just identify them. You got to give them a couple of things so they can do the work or the wrapping up that they need to do. So first of all, who is that identifying person going to be? What will you allow them to do? And what legal steps have you already taken to allow them to do those things? And if the answer is, I don't know, and nothing, keep listening, because we obviously need to get it in place. So again, who will be in charge? What will they need to do? And what legal steps have you taken to allow them to be able to carry that out? Probably haven't done it. So here's the tools that we want to look at having. I already mentioned talk about having a business succession plan in case of extreme sickness or death, that we want to see a way that the business can either survive or you're going to identify who can wrap that up. You want to have a kit that has all your access information to everything available. You want to have all your business policies written out. If they're carrying on for you in the short term, you want to have recorded tutorials on how to do things and how to even, once they access information, what to do with it. But most importantly in this, we want to ensure that we either have this key person on the business in ownership and in management that they can carry on, or identify someone and give them a power of attorney, a legal document that's going to give them these ability to do these actions that you need. Let's take, for example, that you end up sick. We could take the cancer example here. I was extremely sick. I was in the hospital having surgeries. I was not able to go carry on business. If I needed my husband to go down to the bank in order to do something, he's not on the bank account. He's not on the LLC. He would have not been able to do anything like that. What would he have needed? A power of attorney. Obviously, we talked about it. Lawyer drafted, that is definitely one we want to make sure is nice and airtight and it's really outlined and given before any issue happens. You don't want to wait till you're in the throes of sickness or something else in order to get the power of attorney in place. And obviously, they also need to be privy to what your disaster plan was. And I say disaster, but it's obviously encompassing of all these different things that can happen. So make it easy for them. There's nothing worse than a loved one. whether it's a family member or a friend, but a loved one who has you, who's either sick or has died or, you know, God forbid, gone missing, something like that, and they're already hurting and in pain, and then you leave them with no context, no structure for how to help with your business. I know it sounds trivial, right? If you really were dead, missing, or dying, or extremely sick, who cares about the business? But the reality is, these family members and friends are still going to care about it if people are financially dependent upon the business. Plus, what if it's only a short-term type sickness? Hopefully, we don't know what's going to happen. You want to be able to have a business to come back to, so provide yourself that ability for it to be able to maintain itself or at least put on pause for a little bit and give this key person all the tools and information that they need in order to be able to carry on for you until you're able to come back. Whew! I know that felt like a lot of information. I get it. It can be overwhelming. I hope that you guys have a really good solid checklist so that you can go back through and do these items. Now, keep in mind, this isn't the be all and end all of what you need to do. This is a good little tip of the iceberg that's specific to COVID, but there are a lot other steps that entrepreneurs need to take to protect themselves. For example, almost all of us are building a brand, whether we're the face of it or otherwise. We want to ensure that we have things like trademarks and copyright that are going to protect our brand elements. Trademarks protect things like our business name and our logo connected to a very specific product or service, whereas copyright protects visual elements such as our logo as well, and our text and our graphics and our photographs and videos, things that we utilize in marketing. This is one of the areas that many entrepreneurs are really, really lacking in protection. In fact, if you haven't taken these steps, you may not actually own your brand. We touched on it a little bit earlier in the video. You know, intellectual property ownership was one of the contract documents that I recommend that you have in place because you want to own all the assets that you're using. And I feel this is extremely important all the time, but even more so during COVID. We are all working in a virtual-based environment. People are consuming our content online because we can't see one another. So you're putting out video, or you're putting out text, or you're putting out static photos. Well, every time you put it out there, there's a risk for people being able to take and utilize it. You're the one that's put all the time, money, and energy into creating that. Why would you just allow someone else to do it? So not only do you want to own the brand and make sure that it's yours and that no one can stop you from using it, because I bet many of you are sitting on a logo right now that you had created and you didn't get the rights transferred over. And if especially if there was no contract in place, at any time, that logo designer could stop you from utilizing the very source indicator, the very indicator of your brand, a visual element that's extremely important. That's just one example. We could even move that into brand photography as an example. Many of you do not own your brand and you're not set up to when your visual assets be infringed. It is rampant, and I feel like it ramped up even more during COVID. People are at home and they're also stuck, and it's just really easy if they go, oh, I just love that photograph that gal just posted on Instagram. I'm gonna go share and use it as my own. Well, if it was yours, you own it. Own your brand. Don't let other people ride on your coattails there. Make sure that you own it and that you're legally set up to be able to enforce the rights in that ownership. So trademark and copyright to go along with this. And obviously, it has a tie into the contracts as well. Now, I know I just threw two more things at you that you needed to get under control. I get it, it's overwhelming, but you're smart. You're in business for a reason. You have all this time, money, and energy invested. Do the things to ensure that you can prevent issues and be set up if problems ever happen. Again, not if, it's gonna be when at some point. And I want you to be able to have it in your corner, all the legal protection, so it can be resolved quickly, so you can get back to doing what you do best. Whatever it is that your business is, the purpose that you're set out for, legal is just a little part to help you to get there, to keep making an impact on this world and fulfilling your purpose so that you can create your real business so you can live the real life that you want to live. My name is Rachel Branke. You can find out more information on legal education for entrepreneurs at rachelbranke.com. We've got courses, downloads, free resources, videos weekly, so come check it out. I can't wait to help all of you, and best of luck. Don't stress. Y'all got this.